Hello and welcome to Webcast Wednesday. My name's Nick Sibley. I'm the webcast producer, and Alan Sweetenham is going to be presenting this morning's webcast, which is all about discovering PhotoView 360, which is part of SolidWorks Professional. So without further ado, I'll hand you over to Alan.
Thanks, Nick. I'll make this fairly short and sweet, but just the agenda for this webcast. As far as PhotoView 360 is concerned, it's a very quick package to use. I always say it's going to put me out of a job one day because I won't have to train anyone to use it soon. It's very simple to apply appearances. I'll also go through how you can remove all existing appearances. If you want to just start off from a blank image, that's what I'm going to do today. It's just start off from really scratch and then apply everything I need to, appearances, decals or stickers, whatever you want to call them. And then I'll look at the settings and custom appearances to how we can change maybe just the color or even do things like the speaker grill as an appearance rather than modeling it. Finally, I'll look at setup for saving views and also the final settings for quality, etc. And we'll do all that within 20 minutes. I'll just switch back to SolidWorks now. So I've got a model here. As it happens, it's not completely blank at the moment, but I just thought it's a common question I get asked. How can I remove all the existing appearances? You could go through one by one. You could click on each one, click on the appearance call out, and click on the X. But there may be multiple appearances applied. You can also use the display pane at the top here. If you've done any of the training courses, you might have seen that, and there's a column here for appearances. But it can be quite time consuming. So I just thought I'd share a tip. Obviously, do bear in mind this may affect the part models as well. So before you do it, just consider the effect. You may wipe out all the appearances from your part files, but that's what I want to do in this case. I've selected my display manager, and I make sure I'm on appearances. So there's three columns, appearances, decals, light, scene, and camera. You can sort them by alphabetical order, history, so the order they were applied in, or hierarchy. That can help diagnose problems. Here I'm going to just sort by history or alphabetical. Select all of them by holding shift, selecting the first appearance, selecting the last. Now just be careful here, because if you right click and choose remove appearance, that will only remove one appearance. I would like that to be changed, but at the moment it's just the case that you select all of them, so hold shift, select the first, select the last, press delete on your keyboard, and that will remove all appearances. On a large assembly, this can be quite a few, so it may take a little while to see it sort of fly around the screen. In this case, it's just a few to remove, so just delete on the keyboard, and that removes all the appearances. So I've got something to start from scratch. Now, as far as applying the appearances, what I need to do is go here on the right-hand side to apply them. Materials are physical items. They add mass and physical properties that can be used for simulation. Think of the appearances on the right-hand side. These are just like a finish. So they don't have any physical characteristics. Think of them almost like they're painted on top. So we've got lots of categories, and you can have your own as well. I'm going to create custom appearances. So it says appearances with color in bracket. I'll just find my first appearance, and I'm going to apply a metal. Now, it is important to also consider when you apply the appearance, where you apply it. So do you apply it within the part file, within the assembly, to an individual face, feature, etc.? I'm going to go through that hierarchy and show where any confusion can arise. So here, if I apply my satin finish stainless steel, drag and drop that onto a part, I've got several different options here. So I've got face, feature, body, part, assembly, and this new one's a filter. I'll explain that one later. If I go for the assembly level, that applies it to the component in the assembly. That only affects my assembly. If I open up the part, it's unaffected. No change. In fact, if I was to apply a different appearance, so I'll go for something obvious, like a plastic, Let's go for blue, maybe. If I drag that onto the component and go for part level, I don't get the assembly level because I'm just in a part file at the moment here. This is where the sort of confusion can arise. I go back to the assembly, and I can see it's remained as the steel appearance. If you need to diagnose a problem like this, one way is to click on a face of the component that you're worried about. Choose here the drop-down, and you can see why the appearance of steel is showing here. It's at the top of the list, so there is a hierarchy to it. And it goes in this order. So you've got assembly. That will override everything, so that will override any existing appearance. The other appearances are still there behind the scenes, but again, there's a hierarchy to that. So it goes face, feature, body, part. If I was to remove that assembly level, the part level would show through. There's just some tips there. So if you're applying appearances, that's why you may not get the effect that you're desiring. Again, you can apply an appearance and have it affect the part or not. So you've got a choice here. If I was to apply the steel again, this time I'll drag and drop it onto here, and I'll choose the fourth one in. That's the part level. Now, if I was to open that part file, you would see the appearance has been applied. So that's got that steel appearance within the part file. Other things that can happen, just be a bit careful. If you're dragging appearances into here, when you drag an appearance into the screen, left click and drag, if you miss everything, it turns the entire assembly black, or whatever color you were dragging in. You can undo it. When you do that, just pick rebuild. So if you undo, it doesn't disappear. Just click on the rebuild. That will go away. But you don't always realize you've done it, well, at least not until you've saved it and you've already got the problem then. So other ways of finding out why a particular appearance is overriding another. If I do the same thing again, drag and drop, and the way it happened that time is it dragged and dropped and just missed all the components. Can also happen if you double-click on an appearance, apply it to everything, either the entire part or the entire assembly. Now, if you're struggling to diagnose why this appearance has been applied, you can change on your display manager, you can change the sort order and choose hierarchy. And this is one of these easy-to-use tools in SolidWorks where you can find out why it's overriding. So you can see assembly, that's overriding what's being applied at part level. You can also see this on the display pane. If you're on the feature manager and you click the arrows here at the top, little chevrons. In the third column, you can see the appearance of the high-gloss plastic. This black plastic has been applied at assembly level. And again, you can also click on it there to remove it. Now I'm going to continue applying appearances. It's really easy to just drag and drop. So I'm going to go for some plastic. There are some new ones for SolidWorks 2014, for instance, the soft-touch plastics. You often see these on sort of mobile phones, consumer design products. Just gives them a more sort of high-end finish rather than shiny plastic. Now you'll see, depending on your graphics card, you'll see a bit of feedback about how shiny the appearance is, etc., when you have RealView graphics on. That's on the view settings here. You can turn RealView graphics on or off. So if they're off, you just get sort of the color of the appearance. When RealView graphics is on, it's calculating in real time how the reflection would fall on the surface. And that can give you a bit of feedback. If you want more, at this point, I'm going to turn on PhotoView 360. So PhotoView 360 you can find under Tools and Add-ins, or I tend to have the Office Products tab up, so I can easily turn that in on or off. So Office Products, you can toggle it on for this session, PhotoView 360, and that will also add the Render Tools tab automatically, series of tools you might need. So this is where the first time we actually need SolidWorks to have PhotoView 360 turned on. Do we want a better feedback on how these appearances would look in a photographic render? I've got a couple of choices. Integrated Preview turns my graphics area in SolidWorks into a render, or Preview Window gives me a pop-out window. I can view that on a second screen, perhaps, or if I've got a large assembly, I may prefer to just have a small window of a preview. So that gives you better feedback on how those appearances look. We'll look at applying some more appearances, and then we'll come back to this render and see how we get on. You can apply appearances while you're in the integrated preview or preview window. However, just for the webcast, to make it a bit more easy to see what I'm doing, I'm going to turn off the integrated preview. Some more things I need to add. So if I want to add some multiple components here, I want to add here on the top, I'll add some plastic again. And then I'm going to make all the buttons like a shiny finish. So I'm going to go back to my appearances, metal, let's go for chrome. When you apply these, a little trick here is to drag and drop. It does tell you this on the dialog. I know no one particularly reads these messages, but it is useful. If you drag and drop onto a component, if I choose assembly level and hold the Alt key on the keyboard, that will immediately edit the appearance. That means I can then apply it to other components. Because I'm applying it within the assembly only, apply at component level there, I can click on more components and more of the buttons that I want to apply this appearance to. If you're not good at remembering the keyboard shortcuts, not a problem. If I undo that, if you apply the appearance, go for assembly level. That's the fifth one in from the left. If I was to forget the Alt key, simple way to do it, just click on the button, click on the appearance drop down, and then when I click on this, so there's the assembly level, that's a chrome plate. I can then just select that appearance, it edits it, and I can just click on more buttons to add that to all of them. If I want to make a change to any of these, so perhaps I'm not happy with the color of the surround here on the top, just click on the appearance. So if I use the appearance callout again, so just left click on the component, click on this drop down, and I'll make a change to it. Just a simple change in this case, going to make it a bit darker. You can enter the amount of red, green, and blue here, or you can double click on the color just to bring out some more controls. So you can adjust the darkness here. So I'm going to go right down to the very lowest, almost. And now, if I want to save that, all I need to do is click on Advanced. This gives me more controls, and I can save the appearance. If you've got the basic options on, you won't see the save option. So if you make any change to an appearance, whether it's just changing a color like I have, or perhaps changing a texture, so changing an image that a appearance is based on, then you can easily just save it. I've created a custom folder here, so C drive, custom appearances, and I might then go into a subfolder, plastics, and then I'll just save this. It saves it as a .p2m file. You don't really need to know much about those. They're just really a text file which stores all of the properties, so how much red, green, and blue is in the image, how reflective it is, etc. It's asking me if I want to make that folder visible, so it will appear on my appearances as an option on the right-hand side. If I say yes to that. Again, if you change anything else, like the illumination settings here, so if I change how reflective it is, a good idea to have the dynamic help on as well. You can hover over these to see what would change. If I change any of these, just remember to go back and save it if you want to use that elsewhere. And remember, it will also appear here on the right-hand side. I've now got a new folder, and that stores all of my different colors I've already saved. I'll apply a few more appearances. Let's go back to my plastics. Let's just apply an appearance under here, and then onto the speaker. Now, the speaker presents a little bit of a problem. Ideally, I'd like it to show as holes. I didn't want to model all of those little diamond cutouts, so now I need to look at a way that I could apply this. So if you've got anything that's a mesh or something you just want to represent as a finish rather than modeling it, it's perfectly possible to do that with an appearance. If I just edit this standard appearance, on the Surface Finish tab, So again, you only get this if you've got advanced stored. So as long as you've clicked on that once, you'll be fine. You've got several options. So you've got circular hole mesh, diamond hole mesh, or you can have your own custom. That requires you to pick an image. So if I just resize this, so I've got controls for hole size. And I've also got controls for the size of the texture. So if I change the size of the texture under mapping, so anything that has a scale like wood grain or brushed appearances, you want to change the mapping scale. So I set that to be 5 millimeters, for instance, and 5 for the height. And I can just adjust this. So you see as I zoom in, you can see the size and the distance they are apart. So you could adjust the hole size, or you could adjust the mapping scale. So if I make the mapping a little bit smaller, maybe 3 millimeters. Should have had fixed aspect ratio ticked here. That would have made it a lot easier. And again, under surface finish, I can adjust the size of the hole so I can make them bigger or smaller. Just have a look at how that's appearing on my preview. So if I choose integrated preview or preview window, we can get a bit of feedback. Take a little bit longer to render, but this also gives me a good chance to say, wherever you hover your mouse over, it will render that area first. So it only works in the preview, but wherever you're interested in, you can just hover your mouse over it, and it will start rendering. Final touch on here, I could really do some screen graphics. I'm going to do that by adding my own custom decal. What I would advise, I've just turned off the integrated preview to make this a bit clearer, but if you want to apply a decal, rather than applying it at assembly level, because it will try and wrap all the way around the component, just edit the part or open it in its own window. So I'm going to click on it and choose Edit Part. So I'm just working on that one. Decals are usually applied at part level, as that will allow you to map it to an individual surface rather than it trying to wrap around the entire component. If I just select that face, Render Tools, it says Edit Decal, although that allows you to create your own decal. So just click on Edit Decal, and that allows you to create a custom decal. Yeah, I'll just browse for the image. I've got some folders set up here with some images in, and I'm just going to apply my screen graphics. Under mapping, you get these controls for both appearances and decals. I can choose fit width or fit height to selection. So I know it's going to be the right size and not be faffing around with those to work out that it was 48.1 millimeters for the scale of the image. Other things to make it look more realistic, under illumination, I can add some reflection. I'm going to leave that off for now to show two things. The first thing is, if you don't save it, the decal will be called test. So if I click on that surface, click on the appearance drop-down, you can see it's just called test. Please remember to rename them, otherwise it gets a little bit confusing. I'll just edit that appearance. And then I'll just set under illumination, I'll add some reflectivity to make it look a bit more realistic. You can also play about with luminous intensity to make it look like it's backlit. Under image, I'll then save the decal. And I've got a folder here, so there we go. And say I want to make it visible, so I can use that decal again and again. Back to the assembly, and you can see that's all held. Last little tip. When you want to frame your image, it will prompt you to put perspective on. That's view settings, perspective. So if you don't have it on, it will prompt you to do that when you try to render. If you want to modify the amount of perspective, that's view, modify, and perspective. The lower the number, the more perspective effect. So if I set that to be 0.5, you'll see it gives more perspective effect. Set on the value somewhere in between. Finally, to frame the image, if you're not using cameras, which I'll cover this afternoon in a webcast, just collapse the feature manager and press fit to screen. F on the keyboard, seam to fit, or double click your middle mouse button. If you don't do that, it takes into account the feature manager, which is quite sensible usually. So if I just demonstrate, I'm zooming around here, I press F on the keyboard to fit to screen, it doesn't centralize it. Collapse the feature manager and press F again, that centralizes your image, and it means your render will also be centralized. Finally, if you do want to save that, you can press the space bar and you can save a view. To save a view, you've got new view there. Little telescope with a star by it. That'll be able to be recalled here. And from SolidWorks 2013 onwards, you can also save so it's available in all documents. Just bear in mind, obviously, the scale of the product does matter, so you may need several for different size objects. But if you do click that save, it will save it for use in all SolidWorks documents, not just this one. You can also transfer those between machines using the copy settings wizard. Last couple of settings. Under options, render tools, options, there's a whole set of options just for PhotoView. The size of the image, and you can choose various presets. So these would be good enough just for a quick render that you want to put on a PowerPoint presentation perhaps. You may need to increase that for printing, because the size of the pixels is the most important thing. Setting the final render quality, well, good is the standard setting. That's our quickest setting, but you will notice usually the most difference from going from good to better. That's usually sufficient for most renders, and then I would just increase the pixel size rather than increasing the final render quality. You'll often notice very little difference by increasing that final render quality. Pixel size is more important if you're going to be printing. So just click on Integrated Preview, check I'm happy with how it looks at the moment, and then click on Final Render. Shouldn't take too long at this sort of scale. This is just the resolution of my screen at the moment. So it's fine for a very quick image, perhaps to send along. It's just going to be viewed on a computer. But if you start zooming in too far, then you'll find that the quality starts to degrade. So if you go right in, you start to see some pixelation. So that's 100%. I say that one took, if I look at statistics, that one took about 14 seconds. Last thing I'll do on this webcast, I'll change the options. So underneath render tools and options, I'll change the final render quality to better. And we've got some nice comparison tools as well. These were added in SolidWorks 2013, some nice comparison tools, once you've done the final render, to see what's making the most difference. Also, see if you are making any progress. Sometimes you can spend ages tweaking things and wonder if you're making much of a difference. Well, this gives you a very nice way of comparing the two images. Generally speaking, it's going to at least double the render time going from good to better. It turns up the number of bounces of light. So the light will bounce off one surface, hit another, and then stop on good quality. On better quality, it's going to bounce 4 times. It also affects the number of bends of light. We call those refractions. That will affect clear objects more. So where you've got something that's clear, if you get any dark spots, you'll find that going from good to better quality will also improve things. So here, that one took 43 seconds. If I go back to number one, let's just make the size a bit bigger so you can see clearer. If I go back to number one, where you can visually see some differences as I switch between them. But another thing you can do is under Compare and Options, Compare With, click the drop down and choose Second Selected Image. It's where you need to know your window shortcuts, which also work for SolidWorks. If I hold Control, pick the second image. I can now use various options to drag across and compare the two. So wipe is the option I'm using at the moment. As I drag this bar across, I can see the difference between A and B. Mostly it's the things like the satin finish appearances, the graininess has gone away on better quality. And you can see the buttons just light up. They're dark at the moment on A. That's the one on good quality. As I drag B across there, they just light up. So that's generally sufficient. I'll just save this image, so I'll say B, I'm happiest with that. Choosing PNG is a good tip. That will remove the background. Last thing, I'll put that on my PowerPoint. So if I go back to my PowerPoint slides, let's just go and let's create a new slide. Insert the image, picture, find that one. It just removes the background, so you don't get it having problems overlapping your existing graphics. So you can overlap text, etc. Okay, that brings this webcast to a close, but if you've got any other questions, myself and Nick will hang around to answer those.
Excellent, thanks, Alan. I'm just going to switch back to my screen so you can see some contact details. Thanks for that great webcast, Alan. It's amazing, really, in just 20 or so minutes what you can do with PhotoView 360. Alan was obviously going into a lot of detail, but in 5-10 minutes, once you know the materials that you use on a regular basis, you'll be able to create some really powerful images. And I hope you picked up some great tips there. So thanks to Alan for the great presentation. Your contact details are on screen now. Feel free to contact Alan or the support team if you'd like more information on how to use PhotoView 360. Also, if you don't have SolidWorks Professional, you can always upgrade from SolidWorks Standard. If you want to do that, just contact the sales team and they'll arrange that for you. As Alan mentioned, we're going to run into a Q&A session now, so feel free to fire some questions across to Alan and I. If you'd like to see any of the functionality again or delve down into any detail, we're more than happy to stay online and do that for you. In the meantime, thanks again to Alan. Thanks for you for spending time out to listen to this webcast. We hope you've found it useful. This afternoon, we're going to be looking at lights, cameras, and scenes in PhotoView 360 and SolidWorks imagery as well. Okay, so thanks a lot for attending, and we look forward to speaking to you again very shortly.